give the jury your full name and where you live now.
My name is William Bolden, B-O-L-D-I-N, and I reside in the Cleveland area.
And when did you, and there did come a time you became a member of the U.S. Marshal's office, is that correct?
That is correct. When I left the Warren Police Department, I was hired as a deputy U.S. Marshal.
And what year was that?
2003.
And explain to the jury the duties of a U.S. deputy marshal.
We perform a variety of federal law enforcement duties. My primary functions were to serve as a member or in a coordinator of a fugitive task force.
And who is your boss at the U.S. Marshal's office?
U.S. Marshal Pete Elliott is the marshal for the Northern District.
And Pete Elliott is a presidential appointment?
That is correct.
And he has been there quite a while?
Yes, for as long as I have.
And did there come a time when in 2007, and I'm talking somewhere around March 15th, 2007, that your office got involved in an investigation dealing with a Claudia Hoerig who may have gone to Brazil?
Yes, that is correct.
And tell us what role the U.S. Marshal plays when someone is alleged to and has in fact left the United States.
At the time this incident occurred, I was serving as the coordinator of the Fugitive Task Force, which operated here in Trumbull County. So I was the U.S. Marshal's representative and team leader, and we had various detectives and officers from other departments that would work with me on a part-time basis. As part of those duties, we would be called when an agency had a serious or violent crime and they needed our assistance in locating somebody.
Now, have you left the United States to get fugitive during your career as a U.S. Deputy Marshal?
Yes.
And in this particular case, did you become familiar with the evidence, affidavit, facts of the crime that was being investigated?
I had general familiarity about the incident, but not specific knowledge and specific facts regarding the investigation.
And you did have enough information at some point to get a fugitive warrant?
That is correct.
And tell the jury what that means.
When we initiated our investigation, throughout the course of several days or several weeks, we were eventually able to determine that Ms. Hoerig actually left the jurisdiction of Trumbull County, traveled to New York City, and then further traveled on to Brazil. Flight to avoid prosecution is a federal crime.
Sustain that, disregard that last statement.
Okay. As I understand it, then, in order for you to do international travel, you at least need some authorization by a judge or your agency?
Yes.
Okay. And that authorization resulted in you going to Brazil at a future point in time?
Yes.
And would you tell the jury when that was?
The exact date that we traveled was January 14th of 2018.
Okay. And what date did you take custody of Claudia Hoerig?
On January 17th of 2018.
January 17th?
Yes.
And where would that be?
That was at the International Airport in Brazil.
And what authority did you deal with in Brasilia to obtain custody?
We took custody of her from the Brazilian Federal Police.
And what time was that exchange?
I don't recall the exact time. We arrived at the airport approximately noon to 1 p.m., but there were some delays.
And did you have a female officer with you?
Yes. So we had a team of officers with us. When we arrived at the airport, it was myself and a female special agent, Angela Brenner from the U.S. State Department. She and I actually went into the room and took custody of Ms. Hoerig from the Brazilian police.
And how was the reaction when that took place, if any?
She seemed very surprised, kind of stunned to see us. She knew she had gotten moved from where she was.
Your objection, relevance. What she knew.
So, I mean, you're going to take somebody you never saw. Do you see the person you took into custody here?
Yes, I do.
And would you point her out, please?
She's sitting at the defense table.
And may the record reflect she has pointed out the defendant?
This witness has identified the defendant.
I take it that you want, you and Angela Brenner, you have handcuffs?
Yes. So what we did, I mean, the standard obvious procedures, when we first arrived, we meet with the person, explain to them what is going to occur, who we are, behavior we expect from them, and how things are going to go basically during the transportation. And all of those steps were covered during this trip.
You want to have cooperation and friendliness in doing your job, is that correct?
Absolutely.
Okay. And did she cooperate through this process?
She was extremely cooperative throughout the entire process.
Okay. So you had no problems bringing her on behalf of the state of Ohio back to the United States?
No issues.
Okay. And you were on a small jet?
Yes. We traveled to Brazil via commercial airline, and we returned back to the United States on a corporate jet or charter jet.
And you had State Department, FBI, and U.S. Marshals together on that small plane?
That is correct.
Along with the pilot, and I say co-pilot, probably?
Pilot and co-pilot, yes.
Okay. And that was approximately a 9-hour flight?
Yes.
And on that flight, did you have any instruction, and were you assigned to take any statement?
No.
And what was your duty as you entered that flight back?
When we conduct these extraditions, our primary sole function is to safely return the person back to the jurisdiction who holds the warrant for that person. We typically do not engage in any additional investigative steps or interviews or interrogations.
And I take it that the thank you. I take it then on that flight, being a long flight, that you made accommodation, food, drink.
There was a bathroom on the plane, there was food, there was drink for everybody on the plane, yes.
And during the flight, was there a time that Claudia Hoerig said anything to you?
Yes.
And in your own words, beginning to end, tell the jury what was said by her. And you, in that exchange.
Initially, during the boarding of the plane and the initial part of the flight, we engaged in general conversations. Life in Brazil compared to life in the United States, the conditions of the prison or jail in Brazil, number just general topics. At one point during the flight, she made the comment, "A wife does not kill her husband without a good reason." That might not be the exact quote, but something almost like that. I was a bit surprised. Myself and Agent Sano, Special Agent Sano, were sitting across from each other in the aisle. We both looked at each other. It was obvious we both heard the comment that she made. And then the conversation just continued from there.
Did you ask her any questions?
No.
And tell the jury what happened next.
As we continued on the lengthy flight, she began to tell her story, a version of events as to what occurred when she was involved or when she shot her husband, Carl Hoerig.
And tell the jury. In your own words.
Objection. I'd like to tell the jury Ms. Harris' words, what she said, not his own words, what she said. Overruled, I think we all know what overruled. Let's proceed.
I noticed that the time was approximately 6:52 p.m. when she made that comment. She made a variety of comments that were not in chronological order. She stated that she made a comment that she wanted to commit suicide and she purchased a gun to kill herself. She then told us that the gun that she had purchased to kill herself was the weapon that she used to kill Mr. Hoerig. She said that she did computer research on suicide and that research would be in the history of on the computer that was found in the house. She made other comments about weapons recoil, and that when people try to shoot themselves, weapons often recoil and they miss. Again, it was kind of difficult because we weren't asking her questions, and I didn't have enough specific knowledge of what actually occurred in the house to even ask follow-up questions, so we were just letting her continue to talk. She stated that on the day that the incident occurred that she had informed Carl that she was pregnant, Mr. Hoerig, that she was pregnant, and that they had gotten into a heated argument. She stated that he went to take a shower and locked the bedroom door so she could not get in. She then stated that she was standing in the hallway, and when he exited the bedroom, she put the gun to her head and threatened to shoot herself. She said Carl responded by telling her to go ahead and kill herself, but to go to the basement so he did not get blood on his carpet and on the walls and the paintings in the hallway. She said that she got extremely angry, that he started to walk away, and she was so angry that she shot him. She said that she had shot him 3 times, and she was sure that he was dead when she shot him 3 times.
And this was where she shot?
The upstairs hallway at the top of the stairs.
And how many shots did she fire?
She stated she fired 3 shots.
Did she ever change that on the plane?
No.
And did she say what happened after she fired the shots?
Yes.
What?
She said that she went into her bedroom and attempted to kill herself, but that the weapon did not fire, and she did not, so she did not.
And continued with anything else that she told you on that airplane trip?
She told us that after that occurred, she stated that she realized that her weapon was empty and that she reloaded it. She stated that she still wanted to commit suicide, but she wanted to talk to her family first, so she called her father. During the conversations with her father, she said that he told her that she should come back to Brazil, that she should flee. She said that she went to the bank and withdrew money. She then she drove to the Pittsburgh airport, where she flew from Pittsburgh to New York City. And then she flew from New York City on to Brazil. She also made some type of comment that she had withdrawn $10,000 and sent it to her father in Brazil, but I didn't understand the timeline or context of that.
Okay, anything else?
The only other thing, as we were approaching Akron Canton, I asked her if she'd be willing to speak with detectives in Trumbull County when we landed, which is pretty standard in a lot of the arrests we make, not just extraditions, that determines whether or not we may take the person to jail or take them directly to the sheriff's office or a detective bureau so they can be interviewed. She said she didn't want to speak with detectives, so when we landed, we made the proper notifications to Mr. Watkins and the detectives involved in the case, and then we drove to the sheriff's office.
Okay. You landed in Akron Canton the evening of the 17th of January, 2018.
That's correct.
And are you part of the custodians bringing her back to Trumbull County?
Yes. When we landed, we were met at the airport by other law enforcement officers, and myself and Deputy Marshal Ann Murphy. Deputy Murphy met us at the airport. She and I transported Ms. Hoerig back to Trumbull County, and we were followed by a couple other officers in another.
And approximately how long did it take to get back to Trumbull County?
Approximately an hour.
And so, what's this, around 9 o'clock? What time did you arrive at Trumbull County?
I don't recall the exact time of year, but 9 o'clock would be in the fall.
And do you take her into the Trumbull County jail?
Yeah, well, into the sheriff's offices.
Okay. And do you do anything more in this case?
Yeah, well, once we arrived and brought her in, I met with Detective Sermony and Nucci, yourself and some other officers that were there. Ms. Hoerig was placed in the interview room, and then I briefed everyone up on the comments that she made
Factor, did you take part in a videotape statement?
Yes.
And where was that taken?
In an interview room at the Trumbull County Sheriff's Office.
And to your knowledge, it was recorded?
To my knowledge, that was recorded, and that recording is maintained by the Sheriff's Office.
And have you ever seen it or read the transcript?
Yes, I have read the transcript of the interview and have viewed the recording.
Now, this was not your case. You're second chair in this interrogation?
Yes, we wouldn't normally be involved in that part of the process. However, due to the circumstances and the comments that were made on the airplane, it seemed appropriate for me to be involved in case there were any discrepancies or any clarifications that needed to be made during the interview.
And when she is interviewed, how many persons are in the room?
Two. Myself and Detective Sergeant Iannucci.
And when you and Detective Iannucci start talking to her, is that being recorded?
Yes.
And is she given her Miranda warning?
Yes, she is.
And is that being recorded?
Yes.
And then following that, how long did that interview take approximately?
I had approximately 2.5 to 3 hours with a couple breaks.
And it speaks for itself, correct?
Yes.
And again, that was taken by the Trumbull County Sheriff's Department.
Yeah, it was primarily taken. Detective Iannucci was the primary interviewer. It was their responsibility, and I was certainly there to assist.
After that interview, going into the 18th of January, did you have anything else to do with this case?
No.
Thank you. No other questions.
Thank you, Your Honor. Just a moment, please.
How are you doing? I'm fine, sir.
Is this okay, Judge? For a week? Do you want me to go?
That's me, sir.
Just a couple quick things. Good to see you again.
Yes, sir.
How was her demeanor on that flight?
Her demeanor was fine. She was obviously nervous, apprehensive, but she, there were no behavior issues. She was, it looked fine.
All right. And you testified that you felt you should participate in the interview with Trumbull County in case there were any discrepancies or we needed to clarify.
Now, I would say it wasn't that I felt I should participate. It was the decision of the collective group that I should participate.
Okay, but for that reason, correct? Right?
Yes.
Okay, and you did, in fact, participate in the interview in the Trumbull County?
That is correct.
And you just testified that she said a variety of things on the plane, correct?
Correct.
And in the interview with Detective Iannucci in Trumbull County, do you recall saying in that interview several times to her, that's exactly what you told us on the plane?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Are you ready?
No.
All right.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you.